Welcome, everyone. I am Pastor Linda, and I welcome you to this time of worship here at Trinity United Methodist Church. I'm so glad you are here, and I welcome our friends at home that are watching, whether it's Sunday morning or some other time during the week, that we are all joined together and remembering how great it is to be a follower of Christ. Amen. All right. Well, I have a few announcements for you. I ask you to take a look in your bulletin and just keep track of those things on your calendar, but there's two things that are not in your bulletin. One is we're looking toward the holidays, and Thanksgiving is coming up. It has been a tradition to have a Thanksgiving potluck type dinner together on the Sunday before Thanksgiving after worship. At this point, we have nobody to head that up, and so if you're interested in being part of that, let me know or let Karen know, and we will continue the tradition. Also, we are looking to be a part, a presence in the Christmas parade. And we have looked and talked with our preschool about doing it in conjunction with them. LaTerry and Trevor are on board to provide music on the float. And so this is something that we want to do. But again, we need some people that would help us in getting the float put together. And we're looking for a truck. We need a truck to where the kids can ride. We don't want them walking. We'd rather them be on the truck and ride, so it has to be big enough for a few people to ride on it. So if you have interest in being part of that, please let me know. We need to know that we've got everybody by the 13th, which is a deadline to for us to register to be a part of that. So if you're interested in helping with the Christmas parade or the Thanksgiving dinner, please let me know. The other thing, as we start a new month, I do a book club once a month, which is we just read during the month and then gather by Zoom or in person. We'll be Zoom this time. And just talk about the book. What did you like? What didn't you like? What questions you have? And it's a sort of time. So this, I want to tell you today, so you'll have the book for the month to read. It's called The Will of God. This is a classic by Leslie Weatherhead, one of my favorites. And we have copies of this that are out there. So please pick one up if you would like to be part of the book club this month. So The Will of God, Leslie Weatherhead. I am so glad each one of you is here. This is World Communion Sunday. It is a time when Christians all around the world are gathering together, are celebrating communion, and are recognizing that we aren't just in our own little silo, our own little space, but it is reminding us of the worldwide church and that we are part of something much greater. Much greater. And so this is a great day, a great celebration that we have for us here in little old Sarasota and around the world. So I am glad that we are gathering for this time of worship. I'm going to invite you to stand, and let's see, we have our opening hymn. I don't have it. Thank you. You've got it. So I invite you to stand. Let's join our voices together, and it is great to worship together.
Please stand and join me responsively in the invocation. Lord, on this World Communion Sunday, all around the world, people hold hands around your table and offer thanks. All around the earth, some cry for food, some are filled with laughter, all search for truth. Throughout this day, across many lands, help us today to celebrate the tie that binds us to fellow Christians in our neighborhood and throughout this planet. Our sisters and brothers touch the bread of life and drink the cup of joy. Today we celebrate the tie that binds us to fellow Christians everywhere. Please.
As we gather in prayer today, I just want you to sort of picture our sanctuary, picture places around the world maybe that you've visited. Picture that God's people everywhere are gathered on this day around one large table to pray, to celebrate, and to be thankful. Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, on this day, we are thankful. We recognize that you are just throughout the world, that you touch lives in so many places. You see each one of us, not only here in Sarasota, but in other places as well. We are thankful, Lord, to be reminded that we are part of something so much bigger than we can even imagine, that your kingdom welcomes all. And for that, we are grateful. Lord, on this day, we also remember that a year ago, people were struggling to recover from Hurricane Ian. Somewhat times it seems so long ago, Lord, and yet it may seem very short. We are thankful for all of us that survived and did so well, but our minds and our hearts are with those that are continuing to struggle, continuing to try to put their lives back together, to rebuild their homes, their livelihoods, their hope. So Lord, on this day, and as we remember, help us to keep all those people for whom the storm damaged. We pray for their healing and their wholeness. And Lord, we thank you for our time to gather together. We pray your Holy Spirit will touch each of us. We come before you seeking forgiveness for the ways in which we disappoint you, hurt you, and hurt others. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to seek repentance, have the courage to draw back to you in hope and in knowledge that you love us. So, Lord, may your Holy Spirit fall on each of us today, bringing healing of body and soul. Bless our time. And most of all, Lord, we thank you for the blessing you are in our lives. And it is with that joy and hope that we join our voices together to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand as we affirm our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost.
Would you pray for me as I pray for you? Come, Holy Spirit. Fill the hearts of your people everywhere. Open our hearts and our minds to hear the particular message that you have for each one of us today. And I pray, Lord, that the words I say are not my own, but are yours. Amen. What does it mean to be a disciple? What does it mean to follow Jesus? That's what we are going to be looking at through this season of fall. Is how does following Jesus change us? Our theme for the fall, not only in sermons, but in a lot of things that we will be doing, is disciples make a difference. And one of the things that I'm going to invite you to do starting next week, as we're looking at the different themes and ways of being a disciple during these next 2 months, is there will be a bulletin board outside of the church. And I want you to intentionally begin to think about, what are you doing during the week to be a disciple of Christ? And as we're looking at all the different levels, it's not a one-time thing. You can keep adding. We'll have pieces of paper where you can write something that you've done that you feel is following Jesus, and just stick it on the board. You don't need to put your name on it. My hope is, as this fall goes on, that we will just see a bulletin board full of examples of people that are making a difference through their discipleship. So look for the board next week. Now, last week we talked about that disciples really need to not just be nominal disciples or Christians, but that we need to be all in and really committed to following Christ. This week, I want to talk a little bit about how disciples seek others. Now, I could have turned it and say this is the evangelism speech, but right now, the word evangelism has unfortunately got several connotations, and they're not all positive, and it's gotten political. So I'm talking about, how do we seek other people? How do we follow Christ and do what he did? Because one of Jesus' priorities was seeking others. In Luke 19:10, he said this when people were sort of talking about who you are. He said, "The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Right from the beginning, he's saying who he is and what he is here to do. Our scripture today talks about seeking the lost. It is from the book, again, of Luke. If you have your Bible with you, turn to Luke 15. Verses 1 through 10. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country, which means leaves them unprotected, leaves them in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Here we have two parables that talks about this idea of seeking the lost. Well, what was the problem that was going on with Jesus right at this point? What was he dealing with? He was having the religious leaders that were saying to him, "You're doing the wrong thing. You are hanging out with the wrong people." Who were the people he was hanging out with? Tax collectors and sinners. Well, tax collectors, we sort of understand tax collectors, right? Even today, you know, it's a little shaky on the tax stuff. But the one problem with tax collectors then, besides the money issue, is that they were hanging out with Gentiles. The people that they were with weren't people that were really accepted to many of these religious leaders. And they were working for the Romans and the emperor. But then we have the sinners. Was he very specific in how these people were sinning, what the problem was? It was a pretty general sinners, right? No clarification on what that means or anything. And often there's really different opinions on what sin is and who sins. But what he was really getting at was those people that were pointing to the sinners. And I'm not pointing to anyone in particular in here. But when you point, what happens? You're pointing one finger forward, but where are your other three fingers pointing? Back at you. And Jesus is trying to sort of say, I am here for everyone. And that we need to look at what it means to seek others. So in these parables, you have two parables that are fairly similar, same kind of format. One person who's wealthy has 100 sheep, loses one, and one woman who has 10 coins loses one. Same format though. They put a lot of energy and time and invest themselves in going out and finding those lost items. There is a strategic purpose in their actions that they are taking. A strategic purpose. Do we emulate that? Do we do the same thing? When we talk about going out and seeking others and sharing Christ, do we have a plan? Do we have a purpose in why we're doing it? Jesus is saying it is so important that all people be restored, be brought back to wholeness by a seeker who purposely goes out and finds them. A seeker who goes out and finds them. Now, one of the things that often is overlooked in these two parables is the joy. He talks a lot about the joy of finding that one item, person, sheep. the joy that you feel. Think about a time that you've lost something. Can you think of a time where you really lost something that meant a lot to you? And the feeling that you had when you couldn't find it and you searched and you searched. And then you found it. Was it joy that you felt? Maybe a little relief, but joy. This bracelet was lost for a long time. My sister-in-law gave it to me for Christmas one time. It's a mom's bracelet. It has my son's name in it. She made it for me, or had it made, I don't think she made. I really like it. And one day, I couldn't find it anywhere. And I looked and I looked, and I looked for a good 6 months to a year. I could not find it. And one time in a very unexpected place, there it was. And I can't tell you how excited I was. I did a happy dance going around the house. Do you do happy dances when you find something that you've lost? I was so excited. And Jesus says that we need to celebrate that joy. In verse 7, he says, there is more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who need no repentance. I have a question about that. Who decides the 99 doesn't need repentance? Is that their opinion? Or that's another sermon. But it makes me think about that a little bit. There's a Bible scholar, Alan Culpepper, and he says, when we look at this, he says that typically we want mercy for ourselves and justice for others. But this parable calls us to celebrate with God because God has been merciful not only to us, but to others as well. So how do we do this? How do we evangelize? How do we share our faith? One way that we do it is what I call relational evangelism. It's lifestyle evangelism. Lifestyle evangelism means that we are living the faith that we believe in. That we are a witness to our faith. That Christ lives in us and people see it through our love, our compassion, our grace that we share with others, our integrity, our justice, our service. That people see the life we live, the lifestyle we is a witness to the faith that is so important to us. Jesus is very visible through us in lifestyle evangelism. The second way is relational evangelism. Relational evangelism happens through the relationships that we have. And we find very natural ways of sharing our faith through conversations, through relationships. Do you share and talk about your faith with people? I know it's really easy when it's people that you share faith with, come to church with, or that you know have a faith. But do you talk about your faith when you're around other people that you're not sure? Or you know they don't go to church? Do you still talk about your faith? A lot of times it is that sharing of experiences that our faith gives us purpose and gives us power in life and helps us through the difficult times. To just sort of talk with people. You mention I'm going to church, you know, I just feel so good when I go to church. it just reminds me of I'm never alone. It reminds me of God being in my life through really difficult times. Sometimes that's all it takes, is just a little bit of comment. I've heard many people say to me, when they're going through a difficult time, I don't know how anybody without faith makes it through this kind of stuff. Have you shared that with other people? If you're talking with a neighbor that you know has no faith, and they're like saying something about, wow, that's been really hard on you, I know. Yeah, it has. I'm so grateful that I have a relationship with Jesus. I'm so grateful that I'm part of a faith community that is around me, that supports me. Whenever, Jesus, I just don't feel alone, even going through this really, really rough time. Do we share our relationship with others? How about invitational evangelism? Do you invite people to be a part of the faith community? I tell you, at the first service, one of the gentlemen had brought two people with him. And I said this, and they were like real excited. I said, y'all get bonus points. They were so excited. They were new to the church, but it was like I was talking about them. Do you invite people to church? It's called sort of a come and see evangelism. And one of the reasons we do different things, not just Sunday morning, is because it gives us opportunities to invite people. It is really scary for a new person, a person that has no church experience, to come to worship, in all honesty. And if you ever invite somebody to worship, make sure you say that I'm saving a seat for you so you can sit beside me and I'll be looking for you. So they know they're just not walking in cold turkey. But we do different things that sometimes is a little safer and gives a chance to say, oh, these church people aren't so weird. That was sort of okay. Do something like the pet blessing that we're doing at the end of the month. Bring your dog and just come and hobnob with a few church people and feel the power of prayer. Or some of the other things that we do. It's really important to think about how people come to church. There are numerous studies about how people got to church. I'm going to ask you, if you remember when you first started coming to church, did you come because somebody invited you? If you did, raise your hand. Yeah. How many of you came because the pastor invited you? How many of you came because you saw an advertisement for the church? That holds up to the statistics. 90% of people will say that they come to church because somebody invited them. 6% say they came because the minister invited them. 2% say they came because I saw an advertisement about the church. And 2% came for other reasons. So as we think about reaching out to others, there's one important aspect that I want to throw out at you to think about, and that comes from our parable. The sheep and the coin were part of the whole before they were lost. The sheep was part of the flock, and the coin was in a purse with all the other coins? What happened that they got lost? What happened that they were out, away, and searching? And I bring this up because it's important for us to be sensitive, especially in this day and time, to be sensitive that some people have reasons why they left the church. A friend of mine, a clergy friend of mine, has a t-shirt. It's a very plain t-shirt, and it says, I'm sorry if the church hurt and failed you. I'm sorry if the church hurt and failed you. She was wearing that shirt one day. They had just moved to a new neighborhood, and somebody came to the door. It was somebody, you know, selling something, and it was a young woman, and she started to say what she was doing, and then she read my friend's shirt, and she just stopped cold turkey. And she said, "I've never seen anything like that before." And my friend said, "Yeah, there's a lot of people that have been hurt by the church." And she said, "I'm one of those. I used to go to church regularly, but something happened that just hurt me so much, I can't go back." And my friend said on behalf of the church, "I am sorry." She didn't try to justify it or fix it. She just said, "On behalf of the church, I am sorry." She said, "The church is made up of a lot of broken people. We're not perfect. And I hope sometime you'll try again." So I tell you this because we need to be sensitive when we are talking about faith and joyful, that other people may not feel and respond to that. And if you see any of that reluctance or be sensitive to maybe where they're at. And you are going to go through, build many bridges sometimes by just saying, "I'm sorry," or even listening a little bit. So we think about people who have left. Do they feel that they don't belong? That the doors are closed to them? Do they have a deep hurt that's hard to get past? On this World Communion Sunday, this World Communion Sunday, where people all around the world are worshiping together, are celebrating communion, are coming around the large table that Jesus has laid for us. They are sinners. They are tax collectors. They are people who are hurt. They are us. They don't all look the same or act the same, but we are all united by that large table, by the grace and that transforms lives of Jesus Christ, a grace that calls us to repentance, to come back to Christ, to change ourselves, to whatever it is that we are using to block Christ, to repent and to come back. Jesus invites all of us to the table. A man was once asked, "Is Jesus your personal savior?" And he said, "No, I prefer to share him." And that's what we're going to do today. As we gather around the table, as we remember how important it is and how joyful it is to be part of that table. I'm going to invite you, as we prepare to prepare our hearts to receive communion, I'm going to invite you just to stay seated. We're going to sing the song, One Bread, One Body. And just think about these words and what it means to be part of one bread and one body. As we partake in communion today, we'll be sharing in the liturgy that for world communion that will be used in many, many places around the world. I invite you to share in the confession. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up to your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and an earth. You have made from all of us one of every nation and people to live on all the face of the earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Sebastian, I'm going to be talking in between, and then we'll get to the common reading. So I know I've totally confused you. So. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. He commissioned us to be his witnesses to the ends of the earth and to make disciples of all nations. And today, his family and all the world is joining at his holy table. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks to God. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood, my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and in thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering to us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here and on those at home and on these gifts of bread and the cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with your church throughout the world and strengthen it in every nation and among every people to witness faithfully in your name. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to the whole world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. In the United Methodist Church, we celebrate an open communion table, which means you do not need to be a member of this church or of any church. You just need that heart that is open to receiving God's grace at work in your life. Jesus took bread from the table. He lifted it up, gave thanks to God. He broke the bread, and he shared it with each of us. And in the same way, he took the cup. He lifted it up, giving thanks to God. And he shared it with each of us, saying, "This is my cup of forgiveness, the cup of salvation offered for each of us." I invite my helpers to come forward. Tyann will have, if you need to be served in your seat, when you see Tyann up front, if you'll just raise your hand so she knows who would like to have communion in your seat. And we also do have gluten-free available for those in need of that. We are going to invite the choir as symbolic of this time of all coming together. They are going to come and join us as well. Broken for you. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. You to come down the side aisles and go return to your seat down the middle. The table has been prepared. Come as you will. Come in front of me. As we sing our last song, Bind Us Together, I'm going to make you do something that you don't like. I'm going to ask you to stand up and move around, okay, and find somebody to hold hands with. That let's be connected and be symbolic of the worldwide church. And so find somebody that's sitting alone, and hold hands as we sing our last song together. So move. For our friends at home, this hand was for you, binding us together. As you go out this week, go out and seek those that need to know about Jesus. Share him with your life, your example, your words. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. Share that with other people as well. And all God's people around the world with joy and with excitement said,